a name for Viktor Orban's system of government. He calls it illiberal democracy. It's basically the primacy of populist nationalism over individual freedoms.
On the campaign trail, Italy's new interior minister used hardline rhetoric to fire up the voters.
Fake, fake, disgusting news.
This was a direct act by the Russian state against our country.
We love her, right? We love her. That was wonderful. Did you bask in that moment? That's lovely. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Heather Reisman, and I am so beyond delighted to be here today on stage with these two extraordinary, erudite women to talk about populism and strong men in the world, only not strong men, strong men. And I think it's quite fabulous that we have two fabulous strong women to talk about strong men. So let's get into it, because we have a short time for a subject that I know on my part I could spend an entire day listening to both of you. So just as a quickie to connect where most people's heads probably are right now, listening to the news endlessly about Mueller and the Russian probe and Trump and Russia and Putin and Trump. It is like, actually, Putin's running the place. He's got complete control over what's going on, and the rest of those people living in the United States and all of us watching the US are just seeing him play out a script that he wanted written. And I just thought, Masha, it would be wonderful. And in fact, Christy, jump in at any time. Like, I'll direct them one way, but interrupt me, go right for it. So
so just sum up the whole Russia thing in a,
yeah,
in
just,
a minute.
The entire thing, listen, we only have 30 minutes. But from your thoughtful perspective, how do you make sense of what you hear?
Right. I think a couple of things. First of all, we have to be mindful of what we don't know. And there's still a whole lot that we don't know. And I think we also, as a journalist, I'm also mindful of the information that we do get, which we get from American law enforcement, and in particular from the FBI and the Special Prosecutor's Office, or the Special Investigators, where, you know, we are not going to get a full picture. We're getting a fairly controlled narrative. That narrative right now tends toward Russia's interference influence the outcome of the election, but we have seen no evidence of that. And I think that it's incredibly tempting to believe that story fully and to place onto it, you know, our sort of the extent of our outrage and horror at what has happened. Because when the unimaginable happens, we want to have a simple explanation. And Russia is a very simple explanation. I think that things are not quite so simple. I think that Russian interference was the continuation of something that Russia has been doing for many decades. And the reason that it, there's a deep reason why it suddenly, after all these decades, tapped into something that was happening in the United States. And in the end, what we're going to be left with is that 62 million Americans, whether they were influenced by something false or not, 62 million Americans who had not been robbed of their free will and their agency made the choice to vote for Donald Trump. We're still stuck with that.
But I am going to just push this a tiny bit, a two-part. In your view, is there going to be much there?
The answer is, I don't know.
Okay.
We're going to find out when we find out.
And even if there is a there, to what extent is that, and I understand that you can't, but you have some view. In the end, you see we still have Trump.
Right, exactly. The there that they're looking for is not going to explain away Trump. It's not going to make him magically disappear. It's not going to reassure us that he came from outer space, or at least from Russia. He came from the United States, and he was voted into office by Americans.
Okay, and I think that's the interesting point to excavate. How is it that we're getting this kind of populism, a different brand in different places? Chrystia, let me just ask. It does seem wherever we look, Hungary, Austria, Turkey, Russia, Israel in its way, of course, part of the Middle East always has it, United States, we do see this kind of a populist movement with somewhat different complexion depending on the history, but it's mushrooming. It feels like it's metastasizing in some way. What's your view about how contagious this is, and what's at the root of it?
Another really easy question to answer concisely, Heather, so thank you. And I hope you'll let me, Heather, just for 1 minute, say a couple of general things, which is, welcome everybody. I'm Canada's Minister of Foreign Affairs. My name is Chrystia Freeland. And I'm also the Member of Parliament for University Rosedale. So we are now in my riding, and isn't it a great riding? And yeah. And I'm especially happy that we're here at the Royal Conservatory, which is a great Canadian cultural institution, and University Rosedale is really, really proud to have it here. I think all of us who are Canadians and tried to learn music remember those Royal Conservatory piano books. I struggled with them.
The yellow cover.
One of my kids is learning how to play violin here, so it's a great place to be. We are on the traditional lands of the Mississaugas of the New Credit First Nation, and I think it's important to acknowledge that. Enfin, c'est un très grand plaisir d'être ici avec vous, surtout avec les femmes canadiennes. Et l'appui, votre appui est très, très important pour moi. Merci beaucoup. On the point about authoritarianism, Heather, since Masha is here, I'll start with a Tolstoy quote, which is that great first line of Anna Karenina, that all happy families are alike and unhappy families are unique in their unhappiness. And it's kind of true about countries whose politics is going sour. I think you're absolutely right that there is this broader worrying trend in the world. It's important, I think, for every country to look to the specifics of what's happening in your own country. And I certainly feel, you know, I am so proud to be Canadian. Our country is really amazing, and now more than ever. But our Prime Minister, who I think people heard earlier today, has this great thing that he tells us sometimes in cabinet, which is Canada didn't happen by accident and it won't continue without intentional effort. And to sort of turn your question upside down, I think people who believe in liberal democracy, people who believe that a multicultural society can actually be really successful and happy and prosperous, people who believe in the multilateral rules-based order, and I'm a person who believes in all three of those things, we have to not take them for granted. And we have to really double down on those values. We have to think about what are the issues, the concerns, the anxieties in the 21st century that could make people turn back on those values, and try hard to address them.
Actually, I think just interesting, as someone who spends a lot of time welcoming good authors, this is a point you might both know that Timothy Snyder has made in his book about, so good that you remind us that we need to appreciate democracy. It's not guaranteed. And I know, Masha, you have some point of view about that, about the characteristics of democracy and how they're different under different circumstances. I'd like to amplify where you're taking us here, Chrystia, a little bit more on this notion. Are we just, does it feel like this is this terrible moment and democracy is just at risk and teetering and we, you know, this bad thing is going to happen? Do you see it just kind of as a moment and we should all stop hyperventilating and just assume it's going to get better? Or do you feel some legitimate concern? And if so, what do we do with this concern?
So two things. I think the theme for me today is we don't know, right? And first of all, we don't know what democracy is, right? Democracy is not a set of mechanisms. Democracy is a set of aspirations. Democracy always lives in the imagination, right? Democracy is always something that we're trying to create. We're trying to create a way of governing by the people who are being governed. It is never going to be perfect. It is never going to be completed. And so I think that, you know, it's not just intentional. It's never complete, right? We're always building it. There isn't actually never a moment when we can say, okay, things are going to be just fine. Sit back and relax. Because if we don't build democracy, it doesn't happen. As for this particular moment, I think we're in grave danger. Right, and that doesn't mean that something absolutely horrible is going to happen, although horrible things are happening all over the world. But it doesn't mean we're going to, you know, see a repeat of the disasters of the 20th century. But if we don't hyperventilate, if we don't act, we'll find out when we have failed. And if we do act, we'll never find out what we prevented.
Right. So this notion of acting or engaging or understanding, I think that is an idea that we want to explore and explore for the audience, because what does it mean to get engaged? Since, and let me just set this up, and Chrystia, you can start, and both of you, since at some level the engagement that seems most discernible that we can witness feels like it's at the extremes in so many cases. Extreme left, extreme white, extreme right. And that in itself seems to be a threat to what feels like the basic notion of democracy, the most good for the most people, but with individual free will to decide. So what is it we're seeing in the participation that we are observing or experiencing? Does it feel like it's extreme?
I mean, you know, Heather, the way I would start by responding to that is, I can't resist quoting that great Yeats line, the best lack all conviction, the worst are full of passionate intensity. And if I were still a newspaper editor, I wouldn't let anybody write that line in their columns because it's being quoted so much, because it feels so appropriate to this moment. But I think we don't have to let it be appropriate to the moment, right? We all have agency. We're all people who can do things. Everyone who's here, you've chosen to spend your Monday afternoon listening to these, I hope, interesting conversations. And I really believe the answer is to be active yourself. I really like the line that democracy is not a noun, it's a verb. If we want to live in a liberal democracy, we can't assume that other people will make it exist and act and function for us. We have to take responsibility and be involved and be engaged. And, you know, I think that that is, you know, we have to kind of fight back for liberal democracy right now. And, you know, I want to sound the opposite of complacent, because I think that Masha was right to say we kind of have to be a little anxious right now. But one of the things that I certainly feel among Canadians is that a lot of Canadians get that. A lot of people are saying, you know what? I want to live in a liberal democracy. I want to live in a diverse society. I want to live in a world where might does not make right, where we have a rules-based order. And I actually feel that people are getting more active and more engaged than maybe we were a decade ago.
Yeah, we hope that's true. And